back in 2011, in the summer of 2011, myself and Mr. Garrell went for a meeting at the University of Arts London. We had a meeting with Elizabeth Rouse, who's the Deputy Rector, and Mark Crawley, who is the Dean of Students. And we asked them if there were any potential young artists within London that had attended their universities that they could recommend to be the artist of our choice for the Heartlands High School sculpture. They recommended an artist called Tom Price, and I went down to the Hales Gallery in Shoreditch, met with his manager, and met with Tom himself, who had an exhibition there, and we both decided that Tom would be the right person for the job to create a sculpture for our school.
I think it would be nice to have like a sort of trademark of our school that someone will look at and it will represent the school, and they'll just say, oh, is it the school with the lovely sculpture? Yes, it is that school with the lovely sculpture.
An artist coming in could really inspire our children, and it just gives the children an opportunity to see what's out there in terms of art and what's being created. And here at Heartlands, we also actively encourage creativity. We have search days where children are given the opportunity to step out of the curriculum a little bit and just indulge in their more creative side. And I think bringing in other artists to inspire our kids is a wonderful, wonderful opportunity.
On track, right?
How do we describe texture when we're doing a drawing?
Okay guys, so this is where the sculpture is actually going to be. It's going to be right in the middle of the allotment area so that all the students and the staff can see it from the school, but it's also going to be so the community can see it from Wood Green too. So it's in a prime location and it's going to be the best place for everyone to view it.
What would you like Tom Price's sculpture to bring to Heartlands High School?
What's really important for the school is that the students here see the sculpture as an aspirational piece of artwork. So they can walk up to the north playground, they'll be able to view it in the allotment area. But the other part of the important part of the sculpture is that the community outside of the school can see the sculpture too. It's going to be raised up quite high. Everyone in Wood Green Common or travelling on the bus up to Alexandra Palace will be able to see it. It's going to be lit at night time, and it's going to be a piece of community art as well as a piece of art for the school. And that's one of the most important reasons why we decided to commission Tom to come and work with us.
It changes, and as I kind of progress through life, oh god, I'm sounding old now, through college, it's different people. When I was younger, I was very much into kind of like drawn cartoons, animations, but the really kind of luscious kind of Studio Ghibli Japanese kind of animations. I was taken to the British Museum and to the Hornby Museum by my mum when I was a kid, and kind of shown little African sculptures and stuffed kind of animals and suits of armour at all sorts of museums. So I think it's different kind of different moments of exposure to kind of different forms of art, which are now being put into museums. And so that got me interested into art generally. I liked making things. And then I started looking around at, well, who makes things that I like? And so I was looking at artists, I don't know, when I was much younger would be Alberto Giacometti who makes these kind of very elongated forms of men and women, women standing statically and men kind of walking. And he does very small things, and he was very interested in perspective. And it was something which I'd noticed. I used to make wire sculptures, and the reason I liked Giacometti is because I thought his sculptures look like my sculptures, so that's how vain I am. But then I started to look into, so where does he get his inspiration from? And I realised that actually his inspiration was kind of obviously coming from African art, but also Etruscan, so quite old votive or religious sculptures, which looked almost identical. And so that's why, instead of being absolutely influenced by, say, living artists and contemporary artists, I really look back to history to try and to see where these people get their ideas from. These people are being kind of lauded up as amazing artists, which they are, but where is it they're getting their stuff from? And then perhaps I can look there as well and find stuff that I'm into. So I wouldn't look like them, I look like me.
I wanted to show you Tom's stuff anyway, but I wanted you just to hold this to start with. I just wanted you to have a feel of what that is. So this is what you're going to have at the school. But this is a tiny one.
A bigger version.
Yeah, you're going to have a much bigger version, I think.
Of a hand.
Wow.
Yeah, I was going to say, both hands. You can feel. I just wanted you to feel it, because it's good to get a feeling of what these things actually are. And now, he actually made that out of clay. Okay. And then there's a process to turn that into bronze, and that's what that is. But what's really amazing about it is that that's not a real person. That's just someone he's imagined in his head. That person doesn't exist. He's just imagined it.
Visionary artist.
Yeah, just molded it from his imagination.
He looks really real.
That looks really real.
It started from clay.
It starts it off as clay. Yeah, then it gets transferred into wax via a plaster mold. And then it ends up as bronze.
So even aftershave marks.
Yeah. Well, look at
marks
this.
Of shaving.
Look at this. This is something I want to show you. Look at this. Yeah. You pointed it out. That little veins there on the side of his head. Yeah. Take a look at that.
So what I have for you now are some of the ideas that I've come up with for the Heartlands project. And I have a little stand-in plinth here. Just all it's doing is raising it up so you get an idea that the final sculpture will stand on something. Most likely it'll be an old stone pillar. So the first one I have, and if we understand that the school is around here, we have the green, so he'll be standing on the allotment, the green down there, and we have houses, I believe, and then the kind of the roundabout and that. So you'll notice that the figures all sort of look away from the school and towards the housing and the community and the space. The next one I'll take out. So this one, he took the idea of the clothing. So this one's very neutral. And this one took the idea of clothing and that idea of what you wear is important in terms of how you communicate yourself to people. And it gave ownership back to the person wearing the clothes. So instead of being judged by the outside, by people, this person is actively presenting themselves. So in fact, they're adjusting. Yeah. And a final one, it was a bit more extreme. This one's literally taking a pose from an ancient bronze sculpture of Mercury, who was the god of communication, but also of commerce.
I think that obviously you put a lot of hard work into them to see, like, maybe some people are like the more aspirational person at the end, this side, and some people like the middle person, who you have to stop and think about that one, because you don't really know what's going on. He's got his hands open, so he could be looking through the world through his fingers. He could be looking at his hand. He could be really doing anything. He could be about to go in a pose.
See, it already sounds like you're thinking quite a lot about this.
Yeah.
Sounds quite promising.
I think that one's it's probably the one that, the one out of all of them that you could really stop and think about.
Do you want your art to make an impact on anyone? Like, do you want it to change anything?
That's a good question. Change anything?
Yeah.
That's an extremely good question, and I'm not sure if I've ever been asked that before. Yes, I do, if I'm honest. Yes, I do, yeah. I think maybe part of being successful with that means I don't necessarily shout about it, but I think I want my work to have an impact on many different people on different levels. I've always said I want my work to function on different levels. So on one side you have the first layer, perhaps, which is the visual, and then people can get involved in how detailed the work is, maybe, or how it looks. So if it looks nice, then you're more likely to draw people to it. And then the content of the work. So who are these people? Why are they there? What is my, or what is the viewer's reaction to them? Then that might lead them to ask, well, why am I having this reaction? And it's a journey which can expand in front of the viewers as long as they're willing to walk down that particular road. So that is one sort of impact I want to have, but I think there's probably a wider social impact that I'd like it to have, which I'm not entirely sure what it is, but there's definitely a strong motivation there. That's why I keep making the work. Yeah, good question.
Imagine living in a place surrounded by streets and streets of houses.
Banks, town centres and office blocks.
Businesses, shops, cinemas and restaurants.
But amongst this urban landscape,
we must all remember the value
and importance of art in our society.
I'm very excited to see the sculpture finally installed here at Heartland High School. It's been a long journey, and I've really enjoyed working with the pupils at the school to kind of finally bring together what is our creation. And I just look forward to seeing what the reaction is from the school pupils when they finally see it, and also the community. Obviously, I've had the clay in my studio for a while, but to finally see it all come together, it's partly a relief, but also I don't think I could hope for it to be kind of as good as it is. So really just very, very pleased with it.